Hi, and welcome to the first ever episode of the N1 podcast. I'm your host, Danny Gardner, and today we'll be covering a variety of different topics regarding the NBA playoffs, starting with the Sixers exit, the Bucks and Hawks series coming up, the Sun series, as well as the Jazz Clippers series at the end of that one. To start off with the Sixers, so what went wrong in Philadelphia? And I think this is a failure on multiple levels organizationally. I think karma plays a role here to start off with the process and tanking and all this different stuff that they had going on. I just don't think it's good to lose, especially the way they were losing and trying to lose. Obviously, they got Simmons, they got Embiid, and they thought those were their cornerstone pieces. They missed on Tatum. They missed on Jaylen Brown. There was a bunch of guys they could have drafted but didn't end up drafting. I think that if you start off with Embiid, he is a foundational piece. He is a star. He is a superstar. He is unstoppable. And I don't really blame him for what happened at the end of that series against the Hawks, because he was asked to do everything while he was injured. He's a center. He's not a natural creator. You should not be running your offense with putting him in charge of being the creator, and that's what they were doing. And that was a huge reason why they were failing. He was a turnover machine, especially in game 6 and game 7. I think he had eight turnovers in both of those games, and that might be the first time that's ever happened in NBA history. The biggest problem, obviously, with the Philadelphia Sixers is their reliance on Ben Simmons and the way that they constructed a roster around Joel Embiid. Ben Simmons is not a star. He cannot score. He is passive. He is afraid of the big moment, and you can't have someone like that being your star. The play that everyone's talking about with him in Game 7 when he had an open dunk and instead passed to a covered Tybal.
Cleared out for him. Tapping his way in. Spins on Gallinari. Gives it up. Oh, he was right there. And a foul as Thibel goes to the basket.
For a layup where he got fouled and only made one free throw. And Joel Embiid even acknowledged that this was the turning point for them in their game.
But I thought the turning point was just, you know, we had an open shot and, you know, we missed. We made one free throw and we missed the other. And then they came down and scored.
And you can't have a guy who's supposed to be your star afraid to take these shots. And that's the biggest reason why they were losing these games, is because they don't have a closer. They don't have someone who can close out games for them. And it's not Embiid's fault, because they don't have a point guard who can give them the ball. And you're in charge of now putting him in the top of the key, trying to create plays for a bunch of guys who can't create plays for themselves. And that's just not the role that he's fit to play. You have Tobias Harris, who missed, I think, 3 or 4 layups in that game that could have easily given the Sixers bigger leads. Seth Curry was fantastic. No complaints about him. But they just weren't good enough. They weren't hitting shots. Simmons was a disaster. He scored, I think, he was 3 for 3 from the field in the fourth quarter of the entire series. He didn't take a single shot from game 4 to game 7 in the fourth quarter. You can't have someone on your team who you're saying is a star do that. It doesn't matter how good he is defensively. And by the way, he wasn't that amazing defensively for a lot of the series, especially when he had to lock in on Trae Young. He was just letting him go by. He was way too passive. You can't have someone like that running your offense. It starts off for them with atrocious roster construction. There was not nearly enough shooting on this team or perimeter scoring. When you're relying on Tyrese Maxey to come in as your bench piece and give you some scoring punch, Shake Milton barely played. Seth Curry was your best three-point shooter by far. Tobias Harris is inconsistent. We'll touch more about players who are supposed to be stars who have been inconsistent when we talk about Milwaukee a little bit later. But you can't have that stuff going on if you're the Sixers. And a lot of the problem also falls at the feet of Doc Rivers. Doc Rivers refuses to make adjustments in these series. He kept going up with the same bench plus Tobias Harris unit in the beginning of these second quarters, and it never worked. It's like, dude, what are you doing? The Hawks have one of the best benches in basketball, one of the deepest teams in basketball. It's a huge reason why they are where they are right now. And you refusing to adjust anything, even to put Simmons with that group, go with Simmons and have him running your offense as opposed to running it through Embiid, just surround him with a bunch of shooters and scorers and go. Instead, whenever Simmons is out there with the bench, he's next to Dwight Howard, who's also clogging up the paint and can't do anything and committing stupid fouls, getting unnecessary flagrants, unnecessary technicals. He's doing what Dwight Howard does.
and you wonder why it doesn't work. There's a reason why Doc Rivers' teams have now shown a consistent pattern of choking away series leads. It's because he does not adjust. He gets leads, the other team, the other coach adjusts in these series, and he does not, and he loses. And it happens all the time. He's also relaxing way too early in these games. The 76ers should have won this series in five games. Easily should have won this series in five games. Instead, they found themselves down 3-2 because after being up 2-1, they blew an 18-point second-half lead and a 26-point second-half lead in games four and games five. That cannot happen. And you cut to Doc, I think it was game six or game seven, at one point in the early the fourth quarter, he is sitting there with his arms behind his back, behind his head, leaning back in his chair like he's either exasperated or relaxing. I don't know what it was, but whatever it wasn't a good look for a guy who's supposed to be a head coach of a team that is currently the one seed and choking away their series against a team that is inferior to them. That is what happened. All the credit in the world for Atlanta for being tough. All the credit to Nate McMillan and Trae Young for being awesome in their coaching, in their playing throughout this series. But this series was more to me about Philadelphia and the failures that they have as an organization than it was to me about Atlanta. And Atlanta could still go on to beat Milwaukee because Milwaukee has similar issues to Philadelphia in a different way. But this is, to me, was more about Philadelphia than it was about Atlanta. And the question now becomes, what do you do with Ben Simmons if you're the Philadelphia 76ers? I don't think you can bring him back. The fans will revolt. He is proven to be reluctant in improving his game. His jumper has not improved at all. I know there are stats that show that he's basically an 80% right-hand dominant player and shoots with his left hand for whatever reason. I don't know if he's trying to make it more difficult on himself. And there have been multiple shooting coaches, multiple players, including JJ Redick, who knows a thing or two about shooting, who have said that he should change his shooting hand to his right hand, and he still hasn't done it. Maybe this will be the last, I guess, straw that'll force him to change shooting hands, but you can't go on doing what you've been doing. He's an embarrassment. He's embarrassed himself now in multiple playoff series with his inability and not wanting to shoot the ball. I mean, that's just what it is. And you can't win series like that. So we'll see if he changes, but I don't think you can bring him back if you're Philly, which now leads to, where does he go? And I think there are three landing spots for him that fit very, very well. Number one, I think, is Boston. He gives you kind of a big. He's 6'10", 6'11". He can guard centers, and he allows you to play with Tatum and Brown, someone who can actually spread the ball around a little bit. Obviously, his offensive limitations will still be there, but as long as you treat him like a center on offense, that's okay. As long as you treat him like a center with exceptional passing skills offensively, that's okay. You cannot treat him like a guard because he can't score. And you can't have guards in the court who can't score. But if you treat him like he's a center with exceptional passing ability, kind of like the Warriors do, Draymond, when they go small, then that's something that you can definitely do. And he also helps your transition game, gets you easier points, which the Celtics don't necessarily do a great job of generally, which leads me to my second team, which is Dallas. Dallas obviously has issues with Kristaps Porzingis. He's not happy there. They're not happy with his performance. I don't know how much Porzingis helps Philadelphia. You'd have to include some other things in there to make that deal worthwhile for the 76ers, because Porzingis' contract is equally as large as Ben Simmons's. But I love the fit with Ben Simmons in Dallas. Again, as a center, first off, he's another passer next to Luka, who's already a fantastic passer, and he gives them a legitimate defensive force, which they have been severely lacking in the last few postseasons. They were sending out Maxi Kleber and Dorian Finney-Smith to go guard Kawhi Leonard as Kawhi Leonard torched them in a seven-game series this season. That's why they lost, because they could not guard Kawhi Leonard. That was the entire reason. They lost in seven games to a team that was far more talented simply because they couldn't guard the other team's best player. That's the entire reason. You now give them someone in Simmons who, for his flaws offensively, is an elite, elite defensive player. And then you can go in and now he can run transition, which they really don't do because Luka's not that style. He can play pick and roll as the roll man in offense with Luka, which is just unstoppable. You surround the two of them with shooters. That's a ton of passing and a ton of athleticism and skill in the half court, at least from the Luka and Simmons, both offering those two different things. That could be a very interesting lineup. And then the last team, which I actually think would be the most fun, we could trade him to Charlotte. Devontae Graham, I believe, is a restricted free agent this summer. They could do a kind of sign and trade with some picks for to Charlotte. And I'm not sure how well this would work in terms of winning, but in terms of fun, I would have a blast watching it because Charlotte loves to get out and run and they desperately need someone to play center. And you can put Simmons in as not even that small of a small ball center, and that team could just play fast up and down the court all the time, and it would be really enjoyable. Simmons and LaMelo Ball, two elite transition passers going constantly up and down the floor. That, and also he improves them defensively because wherever he goes, he will improve anyone defensively, along with Hayward and Rozier and PJ Washington and Miles Bridges and the Martin brothers and all those guys. That could be a really fun team that could actually challenge for a playoff spot, depending on the growth of the entire roster. That's what you saw. That's what has to be accounted for also when you talk about teams that are a lot younger when you're going from year to year, is the growth and development of the young players, which is why part of the reason why Phoenix is so good this year. But I definitely think Charlotte would be my favorite of the teams for him to go to. But those are the three teams I think makes the most sense for them to acquire Ben Simmons, because his stock is not going to be hot right now. And I know we have the tendency to overreact, and he'll probably get traded for a decent haul anyway because teams will see the potential in him. But his stock is not as good now as it was a year ago when he could have been traded for James Harden. That's obviously true. I think that those three teams are the teams where he actually represents a good value add to them. Whereas there are other teams where, say, you already have a really good center, you're not going to want them. If you have a team that doesn't need someone like that, who needs shooters, you don't want someone like him. But those teams could use someone like Ben Simmons.
The next topic that we're going to be talking about is the Jazz Clippers series and the ending to that series. And the first thing I want to talk about when it comes to that series is the Rudy Gobert problem. And I think this is going to be what a lot of people are talking about. But it happened in Game 5. It happened especially in Game 6. Rudy Gobert got torched defensively in those games. And it's not all his fault, because the Jazz couldn't contain anyone on the perimeter and guys were getting through. But there were also some plays where he was getting attacked at the basket, which by Reggie Jackson, which should never happen. And Reggie Jackson was scoring easily. Those guys had no fear going up against Rudy Gobert at the rim. And then they would kick it out to Terrence Mann in the corner, and he just wouldn't close out hard enough. No matter how many times Terrence Mann went out there, was hitting shots. He's just not comfortable closing out on guys, which is okay. He's your center. He's not necessarily supposed to do that. But if that's the case, then take him out of the game. There's no reason for him to be in there if he's just killing you defensively in these series. And we talked about it a little bit with Doc Rivers and when talking about the Philadelphia series. There are far too many coaches in these playoffs who refuse to adjust and stick to what has worked for them in the past. Rudy Gobert may have been Defensive Player of the Year 3 times, in fact, which is looking like more and more of a mistake the further we see him in the playoffs, because this is now the third straight postseason where he's basically been unable to be on the floor because of how bad teams are destroying him defensively. But you're paying him a ton of money. He's a Defensive Player of the Year. It doesn't matter. This is the playoffs. You have to adjust. If something is not working, you have to change it. There is no reason for Utah to blow a 25-point lead in the third quarter of Game 6. Absolutely no reason. That lead went away before the fourth quarter even started. It was insane how fast it happened. And because of Quinn Snyder's refusal to adjust, they lost that game. If Jay just went small with, say, Mitchell and Connolly, or Mitchell and Clarkson with Engels and Bogdanovich and Royce O'Neal, that's a totally different game. And yeah, you really can't stop them, but you weren't stopping them anyway. At least you can score. The bigger problem for Gobert, honestly, is that he can't make you pay on the offensive end if you're going small. He has no skill offensively whatsoever. You put a smaller guy on him, it doesn't matter. You can put a guard on him, he's not going to score. He has no post moves. He has little coordination. He's not a great free throw shooter. There's nothing that he can do offensively that's going to make you pay for going small. So if you can kill him by going small on one end, when you're on offense, he's not going to kill you when you're on defense. So why wouldn't you do that? It's what every team has done the past 3 years in the playoffs against the Jazz to beat them, is go small. And Rudy Gobert has not proven that he can make teams pay offensively, and he has proven that he can't hang on defense. So Quinn Snyder has got to change.
He's got to change. Either the roster has to change or he's got to change. Otherwise, he should be out. And that team should fall. That team might fall apart pretty soon because they've almost reached their ceiling. As much as I love some of the players on their team. And speaking of players I love on their team, I think Donovan Mitchell is absolutely a superstar in this league now. He was outstanding in the games that he played. They were a significantly worse team without him in the playoffs. And you saw it against Memphis. He can dominate scoring and doing other things. You see how his playmaking has improved. His defense has improved. His leadership and his intangibles are awesome. And he wasn't 100%. You could see that with the ankle. It was bothering him all series. He didn't have Conley. There wasn't anyone else to really share ball handling duties with besides Joe Ingles, who could do a pretty good job of it in a pinch. But Mitchell, to me, is a legit superstar. And is he a top-level Kevin Durant guy? No, but I think he's a notch below. And I think that if you surround him with guys who can do more. And I think if Conley was healthy, this series could have turned out differently. But if you surround him with a legit second star offensively, not Rudy Gobert, who's incompetent offensively, then the Jazz could actually go pretty far and farther than they have been, at least. But I don't know how much longer the marriage between the Jazz and Donovan Mitchell is going to last because they have to make some changes. There have been rumors that he's been unhappy with the way things have been going kind of throughout the past couple of years. There was obviously the incident with Rudy Gobert and COVID and how upset he was with Rudy Gobert during that because he got him infected by being kind of reckless and careless. But Donovan Mitchell's good enough to be a champion on a championship team and be a star player on a championship team. It's just a matter of, is this a situation that he wants to be in? And the Jazz don't have a ton of flexibility. They're paying Mitchell, they're paying Gobert. They have a bunch of other guys who are making like decent money. There's not really much that they can do for themselves to improve. So I think you could see either Mitchell's going to stay there in kind of like a Dame situation where he's just going to stay there forever with the ceiling being like they're a second round, maybe on a real, I don't know, weird season, third round team, but they're just not going to be good enough unless they make some drastic changes to be there. So we'll see if he's the next disgruntled superstar who requests to leave. I think that he's probably my pick to be the next disgruntled superstar who would leave because I just think that that team has reached its peak and there's not much they can do for some upward mobility. The next thing we're going to talk about is the first three games of the Suns and Clippers series. And to me, the biggest takeaway from these first three games is the emergence of DeAndre Ayton as a borderline star player in the NBA. Two ways. You can see this is the difference between him and Rudy Gobert. He can make the Clippers pay offensively if they want to go small. He can make them do that, whereas Gobert can't. He's been fantastic. He has looked aggressive. He is taking good shots. He's shooting incredible efficiency. I think he's over 70% or nearing 70% for the playoffs as a whole. But Ayton has been a legit star, and he's so important to what they do and will be the X factor in whether or not they win the series is how well DeAndre Ayton plays. Because between Paul George and the Clippers' perimeter shooting, they can score. And so that is going to be a thing for them. And Chris Paul and Devin Booker are Chris Paul and Devin Booker, assuming Booker can kind of get back to what he was before he broke his nose, and Chris Paul can work his way back after so much time off. But the key to the series is going to be, can Ayton continue to make them pay for going small? And Zubac was fantastic last game, but I don't expect that to continue. But when the Clippers go small and he can make them pay, it kind of takes away their biggest weapon. Speaking of Paul George, I think that the entire conversation surrounding Paul George this series has been, in this playoffs as a whole, has been incredibly stupid. He was not good against Dallas. He had a rough start to the Utah series, and he had a really strong last five or six games or so. This does not mean that Paul George has not disappointed in the playoffs in the past. There's like this rush for everyone to be like, oh, he actually is playoff P. He is this. He is that. It's not that. The reason why everyone makes fun of Paul George for playoff P is because he gave himself that nickname and proceeded to disappoint every single year in the playoffs. Every single year since he left Indiana, he has been an immense disappointment. Paul George performing up to the standard that we expect from Paul George should not be this big of a deal. If he was actually this good in the playoffs consistently, or just good in the playoffs consistently, then we wouldn't make a big deal of the fact that he is good. Paul George having a good stretch here does not change the fact that he has been abysmal in the past, specifically in closeout games. Just to give some stats. In the regular season for his career, Paul George averages about 20 points, 6 rebounds, 4 assists on 44, 38, and 85 shooting splits. That's very good. Obviously, he's a fantastic player. In the playoffs as a whole, he averages 21, 7, and 4 on 42, 36, 83. So a little bit of uptick in scoring and rebounding, but a little bit of a dip in efficiency. That's okay, though. In closeout games, in which he has played 15 of them in his career, Paul George averages 19 points, 7 rebounds, and 4 assists on 39, 33, and 78 shooting splits. Those numbers are massive dips from what he should be, specifically when it comes to efficiency. And that's the biggest thing. He has been so inefficient in some of his biggest games. Don't forget Game 6 Utah, 2018. They were down 3-2. This was a 5-point loss. Paul George was 2 for 16 from the field with 5 points. In Game 5 against Portland, he was fantastic. 14 of 20 from the field, 36 points. With about 2 minutes left to go, he goes to the line with a chance to make it a 5-point game. Misses free throws. It's the same exact thing that happened last game in Game 2 against Phoenix. Paul George has a rough game efficiency-wise, but he really came on at the end of the fourth quarter and had some big buckets. Goes to the line, 6 seconds left, chance to make it a 3-point game. He misses both free throws, which leads to the Valley-oop, as some are calling it, which is a great nickname, by the way. He has not proven that he can consistently come through. It is no longer – if Paul George comes out of a playoff game with 10 points on poor efficiency, it's not surprising to anyone. And that should be because of the caliber of player that he is. It is more surprising now when Paul George comes out and puts up 30 points in a playoff game than when he does and puts up 15. And that's the entire issue surrounding Paul George and the playoff P thing is he has been so bad consistently that we are no longer surprised when he's bad and are instead talking about how surprising it is and how he might be changing the narrative when he plays well. That's the whole thing writes itself. That's the reason why the jokes are made.
Moving on. I am worried about the Suns' health for this series. It is a big concern because Campaign is now hurt with an ankle. Chris Paul is coming back from COVID after a long run off, so we'll see how long it takes him to get back to normal. I don't know. There are some players who took a long time, Jason Tatum in particular. It took him a while to get back to feeling 100%, but this is also before he was vaccinated. So Paul was vaccinated and asymptomatic, so hopefully that should help him get back there a little bit. But the Devin Booker thing is real. Your nose being broken in 3 places, that is not an easy thing to deal with. Playing with a face mask is not an easy thing to deal with. It could change the way he breathes, which could affect his game. Just a matter of comfortability. If your face constantly hurts, it's probably not that easy to play basketball particularly well. But he's going to have to play it out, basically, in order for the Suns to win the series. He's going to have to play fairly well. And I am worried about their health. I think that's the only thing that can prevent them from losing the series because I think they're a better team. I love Crowder and Bridges on the wing being able to guard George. I love Ayton, obviously. I love Campaign. I love Cam Johnson. But if their guards aren't healthy, then they're in trouble because that's the biggest advantage they have over the Clippers is their guard play. And if they're not playing well because they're not healthy, then that's something to be seriously, seriously worried about. One thing I want to talk about, specifically as it pertains to this series, is the officiating issues in this series and in these games in general. Game 2, the last 2 minutes of the game, took 33 minutes in real time. That is unacceptable. For someone who's a diehard NBA fan like me, it doesn't really matter. But if you're a casual fan, you turn off the game. These are the complaints that people have. The end of these games are way too slow, and they're reviewing things unnecessarily. The play where they changed where Beverly knocked it out off of Booker, and they changed it to make it a Clipper ball was ridiculous. That play, for all of human history, has been Suns ball as it should have been, and there was no reason for it to have even been reviewed in the first place. That is a play that does not need to be reviewed. And the Clippers can cry all they want about wanting to get a review. And Pat Bev can cry all that he wants about wanting to get a review. That play should not be reviewed. It was so obvious in real time that it was a play that was pretty much off Patrick Beverly. And if it was off Booker, it was off
by a hair of an inch. It wasn't a loose ball. It was Beverly stripping Booker, and it stayed on his finger for a split second after. That has never been, as Jeff Van Gundy said, the purpose of the rule is not to microanalyze every play to ensure that you're getting it 100% right. That play was caused to go out of bounds by Patrick Beverly. That should have been Suns ball and should have stayed Suns ball after it went into review. It's about the spirit of the rule. The other thing, the other play in that game that I thought was ridiculous is with about a minute and a half left, the Suns were up two. Devin Booker drives and Patrick Beverly flops and hits, acts like he gets shot. Shocker, Patrick Beverly does that. They go back and they didn't call an offensive foul on the play. They go back and review for a hostile act, for a flagrant. And it wasn't a flagrant because he flopped, but it was kind of an offensive foul if you're really stretching it. And they go back and later assess an offensive foul. That, to me, should not be allowed. If it's an offensive foul, you have to call it in real time. You can't go back and review for a flagrant and then be like, oh, no, that's just an offensive foul, and then give nothing to the guy who caused you to stop the game because of how badly he flopped. And to me, this is an easy fix. If you're a player who flops to the point where they have to stop the game and review it to see if it's a flagrant and they don't deem it to be a flagrant, it should be a technical foul on you. This happened earlier in the playoffs, Clippers, Dallas, when Terrence Mann got up and was furious after he got hit on an offense guy going for an offensive rebound. They had to stop the game because he was charging at another player. They go back and review and determine it wasn't enough to be a flagrant, but it was a physical taunt. So therefore it was a technical foul on Dallas. And Terrence Mann got nothing for overreacting so much to the point where he had to stop the game and go back and review it. That makes no sense. You should not be officiating the reaction. You should be officiating the actual play. And if the reaction is so bad and so over the top that you have to go back and review it, then it should be a technical foul. It's the dumbest thing that the NBA is going on right now is that there's no reason you should be rewarding players for flopping because it's essentially what you do. It's essentially what you're doing. The league a few years ago took steps to try to decrease flopping by fining guys for flopping, and they completely given up on that. And they are encouraging flopping all the time, and it's just getting worse and worse. And until the league does something about it, the issue is not going to change. To me, this is a pretty easy fix, but I'm just sick of the over-officiating of the game and the stupid officiating of the game, which is what happened at the end of Suns Clippers game 2.
The last thing we're going to be talking about is Bucks-Hawks game 1 and what should we expect for the rest of the series. This was an amazing performance from Trae Young. In the second and third quarter especially, he went off. He was red hot shooting the ball. He was making tons of threes, making right decisions with the basketball all the time as he's done the entire postseason. It's been really impressive to watch him grow. And I'm someone who's not a Trae Young fan. I find his game to be kind of irritating. I hate the flopping. I despise the flopping, actually. But you got to give the guy credit. He's been fantastic. He's been incredibly intelligent with the ball. He hasn't turned the ball over much at all, which is surprising for the amount that he has it in his hands. And that pick and roll where they have him with either the floater or the lob or the kick is pretty much impossible to stop, especially when you have the rules as they are, which are going to change this offseason in part because of Trae Young in terms of fouling people. But just want to make a note quickly about how great Trae Young has been this playoffs and what they got to do to stop him, which is get up in him. You saw it in the fourth quarter. Drew Holiday, when he decided, I'm going to get up in Trae Young and not let him drive past me, they were fantastic. They did a great job on him. They got a ton of stops. If they could rebound defensively, they would have won that game. Speaking of that game, I think the biggest problem with the Bucks, is twofold. Number one, there's a lot of complaining about Giannis. Giannis has been fantastic this postseason for the most part. He's not an ideal closer, no, but he's been very consistently putting up like mid to high 30s along with like 10 to 12 boards and some assists and stellar defense every game on 58% shooting. You can't really ask more from your star than what Giannis is doing right now. Drew Holiday and Chris Middleton and Coach Bud are the problems with the Milwaukee Bucks. Their inconsistencies have been the entire reason why they are so bad, or why they haven't been better, rather, because I don't think the Bucks have been bad. They are where they are for a reason. But Drew Holiday last series against the Nets, 36% shooting for the entire series. That is unacceptable. You are supposed to be a
18 to 21 point a game scorer on very good efficiency, and you are a disaster for an entire series. Now, to his credit, Drew Holiday was great in game one. He was. He played more than well enough for them to win. The problem was that Chris Middleton wasn't. Chris Middleton in game one against the Nets and game two against the Nets was atrocious, but he played up and down kind of for the rest of the series. He had some great games. He had some bad games. Game one against the Hawks, 6 for 24 from the field, 0 for 9 from three. That can't happen. You are supposed to be the second best player and the best pure scorer on the team. And you are once again, a no-show in these games. I know he's probably going to have a game this series where he has 35 points. Or maybe even 40 points. But they would be much better served if Chris Middleton was consistently giving them 20 to 25 points a game on 45% shooting, which he should be doing. The problem, his up and down performances kill them. It kills them. They don't need him to be spectacular to win. They need him to be solid to win. It's the same thing with the rest of the role players. The rest of the role players on Milwaukee have been so bad all postseason. Their shooting has been terrible, despite the fact that they were a great three-point shooting team in the regular season. Now, Giannis is not perfect, not at all. He has some serious flaws. He's not skilled enough. He's not great at knocking down free throws, despite the fact that he was actually pretty good in game one. But he's been fine. In game one, he had 16 points in the fourth quarter and was incredibly efficient the entire game, plus giving them some A-plus defense and some good rebounding. This is exactly what you want from Giannis, what you want Giannis to do. The problem is the other guys on the team have to do what they're supposed to do as well. And Middleton has been exposed in the playoffs year after year after year for not quite being that guy. And as part of a problem is their roster construction is they don't have a second star, but you'd think that between the three of them, between Giannis, between Middleton, and between Holiday, they have enough there where at the end of games, their execution offensively should be better as long as they do it as a team rather than individually. However, this is where the Coach Bud problem comes in, is Coach Bud's an idiot. If you had a competent coach in there with this team, you could close games well with those three players because there's enough talent between the three of them in every area of the game where you can close. You can exploit mismatches. You can force switches. You can do certain things that will enable them to close games offensively, and they don't do it because Budenholzer is an idiot. And you watch him on the sideline, and he looks like he doesn't know what he's doing. And obviously when I'm saying he's an idiot, I'm exaggerating. He's not an idiot. He's a capable head coach who's done a great job of raising the floor of a bunch of teams that he's coached. However, the ceiling is not high with Budenholzer, specifically because of this. I talked about it with Clint Snyder. I talked about it with Doc Rivers. The difference between good coaches and great coaches is those who can make adjustments in the playoff series. Now, it's an interesting case with Tyronn Lue because they happen to think that he's not a great coach, but he's fantastic at making adjustments and exploiting other teams' weaknesses when it comes to the playoffs. And you saw it against Dallas and you saw it against Utah. Now, should it take you three games to get there? Probably not, which is why I have kind of a tough time calling him a great coach, but I think he's good at that. I think he's great at that area of coaching, which is a huge area of coaching. Budenholzer and Quinn Snyder and Doc Rivers will do a great job of making your team better, but it won't make your team great. And that's a problem. And that's the biggest problem going on in Milwaukee is Coach Budenholzer and the poor play of the Bucks role players and non-Giannis players. Their depth is an issue. And you see it again when Trae Young is not on the floor. The Hawks have so much depth that they're not going to lose those minutes to a team like Milwaukee who has absolutely zero depth. Outside of those three guys, they have PJ Tucker, who has not been shooting or scoring well at all. Brook Lopez, who is inconsistent. They had Marcus Teague playing big minutes for them in this last game. He can't play. He can't play in the regular season. They don't know why he's playing in the postseason. They have Pat Connaughton, who's been solid, but not great. He was atrocious scoring the ball last game. They just don't have enough depth. The Hawks, conversely, have so much depth that they don't even know what to do with it. DeAndre Hunter and Bogdanović are both hurt, and Bogdanović is playing, but he's not playing well, and it doesn't even matter because they have so many guys on their team and their roster who can hurt you offensively because they have so much shooting. You have Gallinari. You have Herter. You have Lou Williams. You have even Okongwu coming off the bench and backing up Capella is a good player, a good effective player. Solomon Hill is not good, but he still plays. But they have so many guys who can hurt you in so many different ways. In game 7 against Philly, their best player was Kevin Huerter. He was fantastic. Trae Young was not good, but Kevin Huerter picked them up. If these other teams, if Giannis is not playing well, the Bucks have almost no chance to win a game. Even in Phoenix, if Booker or Paul isn't playing well, it's really difficult for them to win. If you're the Clippers now, especially with Kawhi Leonard out, if Paul George isn't playing well, you have no chance. You have a pretty much no chance to win. If you're Atlanta and Trae Young doesn't play well, there's a pretty good chance one of your other 7 guys who can put the ball in the basket will do a good enough job in order to make up for it. And it's an incredible luxury to have that other teams simply don't have. To me, this series is not as much about Trae Young, because I think he's going to do what he does regardless of who's guarding him, because I think he's that good at this point. To me, it's more about, can Milwaukee destroy the Hawks in the non-Trae Young minutes? And I don't think that they can, because I don't think they have the depth for it. I think Jrue Holiday has to be matching minutes with Trae Young just for his own sake. And I think when he's not on the court, they have a real tough time. They're going to have a real tough time scoring and also defending, because he's a really good defender. But we'll see what happens. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is there was a report today that came out that the Hawks were complaining to the NBA that they weren't calling 10-second violations on Giannis. This, to me, is complete bullshit. It is ridiculous that the Hawks and other teams, you saw it a lot with Brooklyn last series too, are now complaining about the 10-second violation. They called it, the officials never should have called it in the Miami series. Nobody calls this rule. They didn't call it all regular season. And then in game 1, at the end of a very tight game, you arbitrarily call it for the first time, basically all season. That's exactly 101, first off, how to mess with a guy's head. If for a guy who's already not a great free throw shooter, is start telling him that his routine is too long. When you haven't been doing it all season, there is no reason why the NBA should start calling that violation in the playoffs. And it's ridiculous that they did it against the Heat. They did it once or twice against the Nets too, and it was absurd then. And you saw James Harden especially complaining in game all the time about it. And James Harden's really one to complain about getting the benefit of the doubt of the officials, especially same with the Hawks as far as Trae Young goes. But they haven't enforced that rule ever. And now you want them to start enforcing it? Okay, why don't we start enforcing lane violations, which happen all the time? Or when Trae Young's shooting free throws and he walks across the line before his shot hits the rim, we should start calling that too. Why don't we call James Harden your step back of travel, which it kind of is? Or Trae Young, when you push off a guy and you use your forearm, push off and flail your arms in the air and call a foul. Why don't you call that? Why don't we start calling everything? It's ridiculous. The NBA has always not called that thing a violation. They have never called it. They've never been consistent with calling it. And now you want them to be consistent in calling it. And if they do start become consistent in calling it this series, it is ridiculous and a horrible look for the NBA, because it looks like that they're intentionally screwing over Milwaukee by calling something that they haven't called all year. They should not do that. It makes no sense. It's the same thing, or similar thing rather, with the MLB and the cheating stuff that's going on there with the spider tag or the spider tack. That you can't mid-season all of a sudden start calling things, enforcing rules that you haven't been enforcing all season. It messes with players. It'd be like if all of a sudden you started calling all the offensive fouls on illegal screens, or if you're, again, the James Harden step back, if you're going to start calling that a travel, and you start calling it a travel in the playoffs. Players should stop complaining about that stuff and just play the game. It is ridiculous. It is stupid. And it's bad for the sport. It's a bad look for the sport, rather, if you start arbitrarily calling stuff in the playoffs that you didn't call the entire regular season. But yeah, that'll be pretty much it for the podcast today. Thank you guys for listening, and I'll speak to you guys soon.